more in the monitor, that would be great. I want to talk briefly from the thought when Satan is present. When Satan is present. Let us pray. God, not my will, but your will be done. Not my sermon, but your sermon preach. Make me nothing, God, that you will become everything, so that the words of my mouth, but the meditation of all our hearts will be acceptable in thy sight. God, you are our strength and our holy redeemer. In Christ's name we pray, amen. I can tell you, I don't know how to handle Satan. It's like, ain't hear nothing because Satan is present. All of you. In mid-19th century, the AME Church was the first recorded publication that sticks and stones will break my bones, but names will never hurt me. Trying to ease the blow of insults. But we have a history that says, not sure if that's true. In the history of America, there has been 6 African American people who ran for the office of president before Barack Obama. Shirley Chisholm was the first female to run. And you remember Reverend Brother Keyes was the first black Republican. You had Sharpton and all, and a couple others. But Jesse Jackson ran in 1984 on the Democratic ticket, and history said he was doing pretty good. He put up a pretty good fight until he called the Jews Jaimes. When he called them that name, that was the end of him. Because names hurt. During the Civil Rights Movement, many of you do not know this, but the Native Americans had always been fighting with sports, college sports and professional sports, to stop using their name as their mascots. We know that very well because we have a team here that refused to change their name of Redskins. That's why they can't win nothing. And that's why you shouldn't root for them. Because when you look in the dictionary, 2017, Redskins is a degrading word. And it hurts people's feelings. And so they stand up and fight. And it becomes a little different for us. We have tried to calm down the N-word. The problem is we have a caveat with us. It's only an insulting word based on who says it, how it's said, and whether we put an A-H or E, rather than the E-R on his end. Because somehow we found it a term of endearment. We all use it, but it's not. It should hurt even when we say it ourselves. But it's even worse. Because we have women now that greet each other with a B word, a female dog, let's be clear. And they treat it just like the N word. It all depends on who says it and how it's said. And then maybe we'll let it slide. But names hurt. Gardner Taylor said not only do names of insults, but they are personal names that can be damaging. Dr. Taylor said, if you don't believe it, look at your Bible. You won't find nobody, and you don't know nobody who named their child Judas. And you don't know no woman named Jezebel. Because names are insulting. And now we got a president who does nothing but call names. Call our Haitian brothers and sisters S-holes. Call our black athletes SOBs. Call every immigrant a criminal and a thug. Nobody says nothing, and now we got a new one. Somebody's called snakes. Names hurt. And I want you to get this in your spirit because you need to feel the pressure of the text that there's a name that's worse than all those. There's something worse than a Jaime, an N-word, an SOB. And the S-hole, you can't get no lower than to be called Satan. That's where I'm trying to get you. Feel what Peter must have felt when the Lord that he will come to proclaim his love for looks him in the eye and calls him Satan. You can't go no lower than that. And for years I thought that the name that Jesus called Peter was just over exaggerated. Because I thought Peter was trying to protect God from the suffering. I thought Peter was trying to shield God from the hurt. Let me tell you something. When they said that Peter took him to the side, rebuked him, rebuke wasn't, come on, Lord. It was like, over my dead body, you ain't going nowhere. It was a disrespect in which he spoke. And the reason why the Lord called him Satan, because Satan will do that. Satan will sound like he's working for you. But Jesus knew that Peter was not concerned about him, his safety. Peter was working for himself. You got to watch the devil. The devil will walk up on you and swear that he cares about you. Sounds like he cares about you. Sounds like he wants to work for you. But in the back of his mind, he ain't working for nobody but himself. See, because Peter can't afford Jesus to die. He can't afford it. Because he really wasn't following Jesus for Jesus at that moment. He was following Jesus looking for a position. Let me put it this way, looking for a job. Let me see if I can explain it to you. Remember them two brothers, James and John, the son of Zebedee? If you go into Matthew, this is what you'll find. The mother begins to worship. Show you how smooth Jesus is. She must have been jumping up and down, shouting hallelujah. And right when she finished, the Lord said, what do you want? And he looked at that worship and said, that's not true worship. You praising me and worshiping me because you want something. And he says, what do you want? She says, Lord, promise me this. When you come into your kingdom, that you will put my boys, one on your right, one on your left. Why? Because they were jockeying for position. We're in Lenten season and the crowd will come. And they'll come in, Hosanna in the highest. Jesus will come on his mule. And they're looking for Jesus to park that mule right in front of the Capitol to turn government upside down. But he fooled them and he pulled up in front of the church because they too were jockeying for position. And when they found out that that wasn't what he was there for, the people who praised him will now say, crucify him. That even after Jesus will die and be resurrected, that as they're looking at his living body in Acts chapter 1, They would say to Jesus, well, when are you going to restore Israel? Still looking for position. Let me see if I can help you. That the Lord said, Peter, you ain't come here. And you're not trying to protect me. Peter said, I'm tired of being a fisherman. I'm tired of being on the bottom. That I'm looking to you, O Lord, because I literally want to be above. I no longer want to be below. I'm following you because I want to be what's the lender and not the borrower. That I want to be the head and not the tail. I'm following you because I'm looking to change ranks in my life. Let me help somebody. Some of us don't pray, don't praise, don't look for God until we're in line for a promotion. We're looking for an elevation. We're looking for more money. We're looking for more something. We can't get it alone. So all of a sudden we get religion and you think God don't know. He wasn't only looking for position, he was looking for possession. So Peter couldn't deny himself. Then he says, what does this profit you? He's looking for stuff, hanging alone. We make up 13% of the population as African Americans. We own only 5% of the U.S. firms. And we only have 1.8 companies that has more than one employee. This year alone, we will spend last year we spent more than $1.2 trillion of our money to support the companies that don't support us. That's why don't you know why the bus boycott worked? It worked because we were feeding the company. We were the riders. And if we don't ride, they don't get paid. Because we have all the money to spend, but guess what? We don't have no wealth. You know what wealth is? Wealth is having enough to take care of the present needs and have enough if some future problems come up. But because we want all the stuff, that we don't even get excited about church until I sound like Brother Carey and start talking about you, the next contestant, come on down and get your new car and get your new house, get your new couch, get your new coat. But when the gospel starts preaching about giving a tithe and an offering, loving thy neighbor as thyself, give your life to Jesus, all of a sudden there's a hush over the crowd because we come to know our blessing, but we don't want to hear how we can be a blessing. Jesus said, man, you can't die. I need to get paid. I knew they were going to be quiet. And we keep it up with the Joneses. Who are the Joneses? You buy stuff that depreciates when it comes off the lot. Charge credit cards to make debt bigger. And I'll tell you like the old saints used to say, when you die, you ain't gonna have a hearse behind you or have one suit on, and most of the time you don't even get a pair of shoes with that. We sacrifice our children to buy a house that we can't afford and more space than we need. And then we get mad at the church because the church said, where's God's money? You say, I've used it. And we still don't have wealth. Oh, it's so quiet in here. I'm going somewhere, David. I promise you, I'm going somewhere. And then Jesus says this. He says, if you are ashamed of me and my word, then he talks about an adulterous, sinful generation. I'm going to be the same for you. He says, Peter, because all you want are pleasures. See, we want life to be in a neat package, boxed and wrapped. God didn't promise us no rose garden. More than likely, our packages should become scarred and battered, torn. He came for pleasure. He wanted to hear happy. He wanted peace. He wanted ease. And let's be real. Some of us said, you heard the saying, I got to Jesus and my life got worse. What would you expect? Oh, I know what you were expecting, to be happy, to be ease, looking for pleasures. Peter was looking for pleasure. And God's pleasure is joy. Let me tell you about pleasure, what Peter was looking for and what God offers. And I'm going to tell the story and I'm going to be done with y'all because y'all, I can put a fork in you right now. I had a good friend. I told this story before, but pretend you haven't heard it. I had a good friend, and we were good buddies. We did some stuff together. He went a little further than I did. He actually tried at the time when it was really high. I don't know if it's still in demand because I left that world even amused of it. But that when crack cocaine was the drug, and I never forget, I saw him again, and we were talking. And just got talking about things that we let go of. And he didn't do that no more. He said, but I tried that crack. He said, I tried it once. He said, I ain't going to try it no more. He said, let me tell you what happened. He said, I went and took a hit. And he said, man, it took me for a high I had never experienced. He said, and I sat there that night, and I took all the crack I could take. True story. He said, it wasn't until the next morning when I realized I had spent my whole paycheck. He said that my money was more important than my high. He said, but let me tell you about what crack would do. Crack will give you a sensation that is so great for the moment, you'll keep going back for more, but here's the dilemma. It only lasts a short time. And that's what the Lord is trying to tell us. The world might make you happy, but it's only going to last a short time. The pleasures of this world may make you feel good for a moment, but it's only going to last a short time. Go on and think about the last time you ate a good meal and you said, it's gone now, isn't it? Go on and think about the last time you put on a new suit or bought the new car and you kept it polished for the first 6 months or nine for a whole year, but now it's 2 years old, don't feel that good anymore. Think about the things, think about the boyfriend or girlfriend you had you thought you were in love with for 90 days, and after a while you start seeing the truth, and now all of a sudden you go, God, I don't even believe I even hung out with that person. Why? Because that's what the world will give you, just a short-term piece. But the Lord says, I'll give you pleasure forevermore. And you got to understand what God is saying. He says, even when you're in the pit hole, you'll still have joy. Even when you're on the mountaintop, I'll still give you joy because my pleasures stretch wherever you go. Now watch this. So he says, get ye behind me, Satan. I couldn't figure this out. I said, how did God knew Satan was in his place because he met him. He said, I've been here before. I know you, Satan. And notice what he says. He says, get ye behind me, Satan, but he doesn't get rid of Peter. See, that's what we got to start learning towards each other. Stop cussing people and start getting rid of the devil. I'm trying to help y'all. Stop getting mad at folk and can't get that. And one thing alcoholics got right, they said the liquor made them do it. That's like saying the devil made them do it. Yo, we need to stop getting, we don't fight against flesh and blood. Let me tell you why he's been there. Everything that Peter was fighting for was the very same thing the devil offered Jesus on the in the valley. Peter wanted pleasure. The devil offered Jesus pleasure. He said, if you do this for me, I'll give you some bread. Jesus seen this play before. He said he wanted position. The devil told the Lord, if you jump, the angels will give you charge. I've seen this. I've been down this rodeo. He said, wait a minute now. Took him to the pinnacle and said, I'll give you all this. All the possessions. Jesus said, I know when Satan's in the building. Because he's never chasing me. He never comes because of me. He never comes to church because he wants to hear if there's a word from the Lord. He is coming for his own selfish, foolish pleasures, and I'm last on his list. And Jesus takes Peter to the crowd, and what he says, when the devil shows up, he's going to sound just like this. He's going to try to abort what God has in store. The Lord says something. He says, Satan, you go ahead. He says the same thing. Get behind me, because I got something for you. You ever had the plan to whoop somebody? But you know where you're going to beat them up at? You know where you're going to take them down. I grew up where they had brawls and stuff. Every now and then they get a fight. And you thought the brother had chumped out. No, man, I don't want to fight you. And he just keep on walking because he know exactly where he need to get you. Because you might be standing on a hill and he may be at the bottom. I saw this before. Y'all remember Pooch Campbell played ball? Pooch Campbell was at up there on Mississippi Avenue. And Pooch Campbell, they played fast pitch softball. And Pooch Campbell, nice guy, really nice guy. Wasn't a nice guy. Nice guy. I don't know if he's still living, but nice guy. Y'all might know Poochie. Poochie was hard. Poochie played football with no shoulder pads on, like he had helmet and pad on. He ran. I'm serious. I am not exaggerating. So Poochie talked, just trash talk, never stopped running his mouth. So they playing fast pitch where he won't have to play. He behind the backstop. He's talking to the batter. And the batter, he's upsetting the batter who's playing the game. He's just a spectator at the game. Well, it's two outs, man on second and third, at the bottom of the ninth, and Poochie talking smack to the batter who needs a hit to win the game. And Poochie says something. Whatever he said, David, that boy missed that ball and struck out. Next thing I know, Poochie was sitting up on the hill, and here comes the batter. He all up in Poochie's face. So Poochie was sitting on the hill. So Poochie says, he's sitting on the hill like this, and the man looking down on Poochie like this. Then he moves up behind Poochie like this. So I'm thinking Poochie going, he getting ready, I'm thinking Poochie going to put something on him. So Poochie says, he did just like this. Man, I don't want to fight you. He kept on walking. I ain't mean it. He apologized. But Poochie got on level ground, got off that hill. Poochie said, what you want to do? Because Poochie knew if I let him attack me on the hill, I don't have a, but I got to get the level. Jesus said, get behind me, Satan. I got something for you. Then watch it. He said, I don't need your battle here, but I'm going to meet you And I got something for you. Now watch this. Last story, I'm going to let y'all go because y'all look like y'all ready to hear this one. My neighbor had a big dog. The big dog comes in the house, sits down, and he said he came and laid in the spot, and the owner said, "You smell something?" And they said, "Yeah, smell like a skunk." They realized that the dog that they just brought in had been playing with a skunk. And so they could smell the scent. That's why I wanted to title this "The Scent of Satan," because Jesus could smell him. And so they told us the story. He said, the dog smells so bad. And they knew they had to clean him, so this is what they did. They put him in water, not water. They put him in tomato juice. And they, y'all should be shouting. Because he had the scent of a skunk on him. And the only way they could get rid of it, they had to pour tomato juice. Y'all should be shouting. Why y'all gonna make me preach? He had some sin on him, and he said the only way I knew how to get rid of the sin, I had to pour some red tomato juice. The Lord said, "Get behind me, Satan. I got something for you. It won't be tomato juice, but what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood." Y'all should be on your own now. What can take away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. When Satan is in you, and don't fool yourself, he will show up. But when he gets in you, this is what grandmama, granddaddy, mama, daddy taught us as a child: in the name of Jesus. That means you're going to pour out a cup of blood and you're going to put him out your house. When Satan shows up, give him Jesus and he will be washed away. Don't miss the point. Don't miss the point. If you came this morning to hear the choir, bomb, wrong reason. Let me do it better. If you came this morning because you had to sing in the choir, bomb, wrong reason. If you came here this morning just to hear your wonderful pastor beat. I can't help myself. But if you came this morning to get closer to Jesus, whatever tries to stop you, if you take Jesus with you, he would take it and put it behind you. Now why behind? Because God don't have no reverse. We always move forward. Don't y'all miss that. All of that. So why'd you just not? Why are you putting behind? Because God said, I don't need to go backwards. Our future is ahead of us. That's why you can't keep talking about what you, that's why you can't talk about what used to be. God moves forward. No turning back. Because guess what? If you turn back, I'm gonna give you this and I'm done, you're gonna run into the same demon he just put behind you. Hey, I said something there. If you turn back, you're going to find the same devil that he just put behind you. Wait a minute, I said something there. If you start looking back and going, that's why I said when you put your hand on the plow, don't look back, because I done put that mess behind you. I done said something here. So don't worry about looking back, but your better days are always ahead of you, because the Lord navigates from the front. Preach on, Wes. So now that the doors of the church are open, this is what people do. When they don't come, because they're looking back. Grandma ain't going to like it if I join the United Methodist Church. I don't know if I can leave my old church home. My friends ain't going to treat me like they used to. See that look back, look? But when the Lord calls you, and here's the good thing, come in, y'all, don't y'all miss this. When you move forward, everything that's supposed to come with you will move with you. Don't you miss it? Anything that doesn't come wasn't meant to be with you. But everything that you should have will come. Don't let the devil, don't let Satan control your destiny that God has before you. Get ye behind me, Satan, and move forward. Because the promise for Peter is, upon this rock, I will build my